Professor Yun's The Evolution Theory from the Viewpoint of Christianity, The Thorough Analysis of the Descent or Origin of Man, Lecture 8, Chapter 5, on the development of the intellectual and moral faculties during primeval and civilized times. Man has great power of adapting his habits to new conditions of life. On the other hand, the lower animals must have their bodily structure modified in order to survive under greatly changed conditions. However, the case is widely different in relation to the intellectual and moral faculties of man. These faculties are variable, and we have every reason to believe that the variations tend to be inherited. Therefore, if they were formerly of high importance to primeval man and to his ape-like progenitors, they would have been perfected or advanced through natural selection. It is highly probable that with mankind, the intellectual faculties have been mainly and gradually perfected through natural selection. It deserves notice that as soon as the progenitors of man become social, the principle of imitation and reason and experience would have increased and much modified the intellectual powers in a way of which we see only traces in the lower animals. Previously, the simple fact that after a time no animal can be caught in the same place by the same sort of trap was referred. It shows that animals learn by experience and imitate the caution of others. Turning to the social and moral faculties, such social qualities as sympathy, fidelity, and courage, the paramount importance of which to the lower animals, is disputed by no one, were no doubt acquired by the progenitors of man in a similar manner. Namely, through natural selection, aided by inherited habit. When two tribes of primeval man living in the same country came into competition, if one tribe included a great number of courageous, sympathetic, and faithful members, this tribe would succeed better and conquer the other. Thus, the social and moral qualities would tend slowly to advance and be diffused throughout the world. Ultimately, our moral sense or conscience becomes a highly complex sentiment originating in the social instincts, largely guided by the approbation of our fellow men, ruled by reason, self-interest, and in later times by deep religious feelings, and confirmed by instruction and habit. An advancement in the standard of morality will certainly give an immense advantage to one tribe over another. A tribe including many members who, from possessing in a high degree the spirit of patriotism, fidelity, obedience, courage, and sympathy, were always ready to aid one another and to sacrifice themselves for the common good, would be victorious over most other tribes, and this would be natural selection. Hitherto, the advancement of man from a semi-human condition to that of the modern savage was only considered, but here some remarks on the action of natural selection on civilized nations may be worth adding. With savages, the weak in body or mind are soon eliminated. We civilized men, on the other hand, do our utmost to check the process of elimination. The aid which we feel impelled to give to the helpless is mainly an incidental result of the instinct of sympathy. It was originally acquired as part of the social instincts, but subsequently rendered more tender and more widely diffused. We must therefore bear the undoubtedly bad effects of the weak surviving and propagating their kind. But there appears to be at least one check in steady actions, namely, the weaker and inferior members of society do not marry so freely as the sound. Hence, in civilized nations, there will be some tendency to an increase both in the number and in the standard of the intellectually able. In regard to the moral faculties, some eliminations of the worst dispositions is always in process, even in the most civilized nations. Malefactors are ejected or imprisoned for long periods, so that they cannot freely transmit their bad qualities. Melancholic and insane persons are confined or commit suicide. Violent and quarrelsome men often come to a bloody end. With mankind, some of the worst dispositions occasionally, without any assignable cause, make their appearance in families. This may perhaps be reversions to a savage state, from which we are not removed by very many generations. This view seems indeed recognized in the common expression that such men are the black sheep of the family. And with civilized nations, as far as an advanced standard of morality and an increased number of fairly good men are concerned, natural selection apparently effects but little, though the fundamental social instincts were originally thus gained. Whilst treating of the lower races, the causes which lead to the advance of morality have been already said enough. Namely, they are the approbation of our fellow men, the strengthening of our sympathy by habit, example and imitation, reason, experience and even self-interest, instruction during youth, and religious feelings. And if the various checks specified in the last two paragraphs, and perhaps others as yet unknown, do not prevent the reckless, the vicious, and otherwise inferior members of society from increasing at a quicker rate than the better class of men, the nation will retrograde, as has too often occurred in the history of the world. But we must remember that progress is no invariable rule. As high intellectual powers are advantageous to a nation, the old Greeks, who stood some grades higher in intellect than any race that has ever existed, if the power of natural selection were real, it ought to have risen still higher in the scale, increased in number, and stocked the whole of Europe. But development of all kinds depends on many concurrent favorable circumstances, and natural selection acts only tentatively. The Western nations of Europe, who now so immeasurably surpass their former savage progenitors and stand at the summit of civilization, owe little or none of their superiority to direct inheritance from the old Greeks, though they owe much to the written works of that wonderful people. Nevertheless, Europe has progressed at an unparalleled rate. The remarkable success of the English as colonists compared other European nations has been ascribed to their daring and persistent energy. There is apparently much truth in the belief that the wonderful progress of the US as well as the character of the people are the results of natural selection. For the more energetic, restless, and courageous men from all parts of Europe have emigrated during the last 10 or 12 generations to that great country and have there succeeded best. Obscure as is the problem of the advance of civilization, we can at least see that a nation which produced during a lengthened period the greatest number of highly intellectual, energetic, brave, patriotic, and benevolent men would generally prevail over the less favored nations. Judging from all that we know of man and the lower animals, there has always been sufficient variability in their intellectual and moral faculties for a steady advance through natural selection. All civilized nations were once barbarous. The evidence that all civilized nations are the descendants of a barbarian consists of clear traces of their former low condition in still existing customs, beliefs, language, etc. And savages are independently able to raise themselves a few steps in the scale of civilization and have actually thus risen. Many existing superstitions are the remnant of former false religious beliefs. The highest form of religion, the grand idea of God, hating sin and loving righteousness, was unknown during primeval times. In many parts of the world, flint tools have been discovered in abundance, but the existing inhabitants retain no tradition of their use. It is apparently a truer and more cheerful view that progress has been much more general than retrogression, that man has risen, though by slow and interrupted steps, from a lowly condition to the highest standard as yet attained by him in knowledge, morals, and religion. The above is the gist of Chapter 5. Shalom.